They said I was dead, but I'm alive!
It was getting where you got to a point where if you don't somehow regenerate what you're doing, it's not going to come out right, you know? Actually, when I got out of myself, it freed me up. With the energy of punk rock, it was pretty wild. It proves what we always said about punk rock, was that it was something that's available to people who are just starting out. I've always stuck with rock and roll because rock and roll is honest. Punk rock was such an anti-establishment thing that you had the authorities trying to stop you playing. It scared people.
You. You made a career of surprising people, I think.
Well, maybe. I certainly surprised myself, I can tell you that much, because I never thought I'd be... I don't know, I never thought I'd be sitting here years later, you know. Like, we never thought we'd get past punk rock, really, you know.
So what did you go wrong?
I think we went right.
Another battle was won and lost down the Bishop's End last night. The spotlights pick the kids in triumph with a thousand scars in pit fly. See how they run. With a spring from the terraces and black and white, your nobles in two.
It was more important for me as a person to sort of stamp out my own life. And I was lucky. I had a piece of wood with six strings on it that gave me the ability to put what I was thinking into songs and feelings and enjoy it, really. And it worked.
Gen X is a punk band. You look the part, but what were the ideals? Because there was no blueprint for punk at that time.
No, there wasn't really. I think the main thing was you, for us, for Generation X, we were talking about kind of teenage social problems as well. With youth, about the problems of being young and struggling against a world that was seemed to be against you, you know, particularly at that moment, because there was sort of a dearth of prog rock everywhere, with people who could play well, but they didn't necessarily have any other ideas. So part of our thing was like, we wanted to blast that away, just to put a bit of space for ourselves. But also we felt that sometimes that a lot of people were playing a lot of music but weren't necessarily saying very much with their lyrics. And so we spoke about things that primarily were gang related. Really, they're about being a gang of guys together.
Did it feel like something was being born, something that was going to be big and change the world?
Yeah, it really did. It was so massive. It was, you know, it seemed like a tidal wave. I mean, the funniest part was I was able to tell people, you almost got horribly, dare I say it, I mean, big-headed about it, because you could tell people, in 2 years' time, everybody's going to be wearing these clothes. You know, and then 2 years later, everybody was wearing these clothes. Because it was so small, but you just knew that the energy of punk rock and just the fact, the new fashions it had inside, the fashion sense, which... Everybody's wearing denim, you know, so you could wear anything practically, and it was more exciting than denim.
And the Pistols, you know, it was outrageous. They were the naughty band of that time.
They were far more gruff and rough and out of tune and less skillful, but they were so good.
It scared people.
It scared people. Punk rock was such an anti-establishment thing that you had the authorities trying to stop you playing. And I think the other thing about punk too, it brought art, it put art with music. You've got artists with musicians, with book writers and stuff, with that energy. You could wear anything, practically. We brought leather back.
Rubber skirts, thick black latex, black leather t-shirts and black leather trousers and lots of heavy studded bracelets. That was the beginnings of a style for a whole dispossessed bunch of kids.
It was pretty wild because to feel a whole nation sort of move to the energy of something.
Are you gonna be happy?
And so were you following their careers as they were getting deals and as they were getting hits?
Well, I got one before Susie and the Banshees. But yeah, we were watching the Sex Pistols and, of course, the Clash. And that was the point. You knew what was happening because they would tell you, you know. It was pretty wild, punk rock. It was something that's available to people who are just starting out or who've got very vibrant emotions that they want to put into songs and they haven't got time to spend 20 minutes to tell it to you. They want to get through in 1 minute. And that's what punk rock was all about. It was about not wasting time. I've always struck with punk rock because it's honest. And even if it's lying to you, you know that you can't tell with that pop nonsense. It's just what happens to people. They get stuck in a niche and they can't get out of it, and it happens to, it doesn't matter what you're doing really, it happens to anybody. But I wasn't interested in that, and the whole idea of everything we were doing was never to let yourself get stuck in a niche, never get just bogged down in one thing. That's why almost the music I've always made has been almost quite radically different at different times over the past few years. Sometimes someone you're not.
Was it insulting to hear Billy sold out?
Well, it's something you had to fight against, yeah. You know, you had to fight back against people saying, you know, getting that in their head. The more albums you guys buy, the more things I can do that I like. The man who sold out the world. I just don't think that's what I've done, you know? Yeah. You know, I mean, you couldn't stay in England that long. 5 years in a band in England, it's all over. Unless you're that gigantic. And Generation X splits up. It was more of a necessity to go somewhere else. So it was, yeah, it was a difficult thing to swallow that people thought that was a sellout move, because in fact all I was trying to do was survive. I was actually doing a very similar thing when I came to New York. New York! I found a group, we played my music. We played Generation X or Billy Idol new songs. So yeah, all that stuff's always hard to deal with, and the only way around it is to sort of write your way out of it, really, I think. And I'm a dancing with myself, and when there's no one else inside, in the crowd and lonely night, well, I wait so long for my love vibration, and I'm dancing with myself, oh, 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 dancing with myself, oh, 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 dancing with myself. It was just great that there was a platform like MuchMusic or MTV that gave me a way to get through to people, and it was a new way, and at that time we were like the alternative rockers, and it was very hard to get on the radio, so MTV really made it easy for us. The video world, just like punk rock, it was another platform for music, because that's what it really was for me. I mean, when I first came to America, they wouldn't play punk rock music because if you had spiky hair on the cover, they wouldn't play it. You know, if they saw a picture and you had spiky hair, they wouldn't play your music. But luckily enough, the college stations had started playing a lot of punk. And we picked up on Billy Idol. And just because the fact that we were on MTV meant the kids then phoned up the radio stations and you had a way to force them into playing your music. And then that in turn led to me having sort of big hit records. Nice day for a white wedding. It's a nice day to start again.
Does it bother you when people call you a pop star?
Well, they don't call it to my face. Not very often, anyway. When I came to America, the Clash were actually really ginormous. They were getting really big. And I've always thought, you know, I wonder if they'd have stayed going, whether I would really have ever got going in America. But I think partly because the Clash had broke up, it kind of left this huge hole.
Right.
And then there wasn't somebody filling in that punk rock gap kind of thing, you know, so really wild. And then I happened to be there. We happened to have these videos, and yeah, they always slagged me off for being the good-looking punk, but they all had to be real pissed off when it was me staring them right down that tube every night.
Eyes without a face. Eyes without a face.
It's just a cartoon. I mean, at least when it was punk rock days, we used to argue over sensible things, not hairspray. I just used to put hairspray on my head and make my head dirty quicker, you know. Maybe put hairspray on the head. I should keep it in place, the idiots. We had to play a gig with them, and they were huge. We were the support band, Flock of Seagulls. Yeah, we destroyed them. Because they all stood behind the keyboards, you know, and we're moving around. And so we had that audience going there. And it was all him behind the keyboard, and the other guy just...
Face to face, and back to back.
You got labeled, like it or not, as being a sex symbol.
I've always had my sexiness, but,
Is it weird to look at who are the sex symbols of that day where... But then there's Billy Idol in the middle of all this.
It's pretty weird, isn't it? Well, thank God, that's all I can say.
To give them a little bit of a variety, maybe.
Yeah, bit of the lip curl, yeah.
Me to ask you where that came from.
I don't know, it's pretty natural, I think. You know, if you're just screaming into a microphone, you know, just... It says it all, I think it's a you with that. And it's a...
The chicks eat that up, though.
Let's hope so. I love the fact that I've got an ability to perform, and it's really special because when you're staring into a load of people's eyes and they're crazier than you, but it's all to the same music, that's a pretty fantastic thing to have. And I always have had that, you know. I've always, my audience has always been there, you know. Maybe it's got smaller, or it's not as gigantic as ones were, but who cares? I mean, I'll play to one, I'll play to 10, I'll play to 10,000. You know, I know, I'll take to 100,000, I don't care. You know, it's more about how it affects that person and how it affects me. Of course, for me, it's my ultimate moment of triumph, isn't it? Because I always get a great response from my fans, and I always feel as if it's one more blow for the sort of counterculture that an idiot like me is still out there rocking.
You're alive. They said I was dead, but I'm alive. A real life resurrection.
The main thing was it was important to make a great record, and I kind of wanted to make sure that it was something a little bit more about me than everybody else.
Candy house. Steve obviously really did help me a lot, and not only as a friend, but as he's a really excellent musician, and he was able to put into my music obviously a type of musicianship I hadn't necessarily had in my music. So I've got a lot to thank him for. But at the same time, we played together for 6 or nearly 7 years, and the band I was in, Generation X, only lasted 4 years. So that's a long time for anybody. And in the end, I think it was really necessary for him to go off and do his own music as well as play with other people. I wouldn't like to chain anybody to playing Billy Idol music unless you meet, you know.
Well, I had been signed as a solo artist after the Rebel Yell tour, and originally we anticipated that I would do a solo record, but I think attitudes really changed after I was signed. I can't say my attitude changed, because I was perfectly willing to have this coexist with Billy's situation. But Billy and I are very vastly different types of people, personality-wise, and even musical background. And, you know, I come from a hard rock thing, and he's more from punk rock, obviously. And our manager at the time was very integral in keeping that relationship together as a strong, productive partnership. Yeah. And when he was out of the scene, I think other people started preparing for my departure, thinking that Steve has a solo deal now, so we've got a plan for the future.
I think it was more sort of a necessary thing to do to really sort of expand and grow ourselves.
So consequently, with MuchMore record, I was not included in the songwriting, and there was no real drums and bass. And it's very difficult for my guitar to be on a record with drum machines and, you know, keyboard sequences and things like that. So I let it be known that would be the last record I would do with Billy.
Well, I understand. I wouldn't want to sit around playing somebody else's music for the rest of my life.
Come on, shake it up.
When you had your accident, you were not wearing a helmet. How do you feel about helmets now?
I didn't actually hit my head, so I still don't wear a helmet. I mean, it's not the law in California, so you don't have to. It's safety by choice, which I think personally is the correct idea. I mean, I think same thing with seatbelts. I think you should be allowed to wear them or not, you know what I mean? The same with a helmet. So for me, personally, I live in a state where you don't have to wear one, so I'm not compelled to have to wear it, so I won't.
I don't know just where I'm going, but I'm gonna try for the kingdom if I can. Yeah, 'cause it makes me feel like I'm a man when I put a spike into my vein.
Do you look at it as a new lease on life?
What really sort of affected me was that it's just this friend of mine said, you know, we were watching my son play on the beach, and he was just there. He said, you know, your son wouldn't forgive you if you died, you know? So it was a kind of a, is a more a thing of, I have to really sort of be responsible for somebody else, really. Because of that, I sort of put a lot of things that were damaging me on hold. Well, I'm just one of those people who like to indulge in excess one way or another. I didn't realize how heavy I was, what I was doing to myself, you know. You just don't realize sometimes, especially we'd sort of gone through the whole 80s in a...
Right.
And it was still going on into the 90s, and it took something, you know, pretty dramatic to make you sort of shape up and think about it.
I really had to get myself together. I think I wouldn't have been standing here right now talking to you if I'd stayed.
Like a constant buzz that was exciting to have every day. Because I never really thought how f***ed up I was affecting the music. Because we were taking 3 years to do an album. But that was the point. It's just, I've got nothing against drugs, don't worry. Because I smoke a ton of pot, don't worry. But it's just mainly, I just didn't want my kids waking up one day and they read on the news that you've died or something. Personally, I think it's better to ride a motorcycle than to take drugs. So that's what I did. I found a more natural form of stimulation. Once I started to sort of
kind of get clear, really, it made me realise about my music too, you know, that I was hurting the music a lot. I'd started being f***ed up to help the music, and that was the only reason, and if it's hurting the music, that's not what I wanted to do, you know.
So actually, the only addiction I've got at the minute is to rock and roll, and I can't seem to shake it.
Originally, one of my biggest ideas when I came to America was to fuse rock and roll and technology. And that's what I tried to do on Whiplash Smile, and it had turned around and bitten me. I'd gone back to the usual way of recording on CHUM Live. That had hurt. And so finding out that the 90s technology had taken such a vast step, I realized that I could start using technology to my advantage. And a lot of this understanding that technology had come a long way came from, at first, reading about it through cyberpunk novels like William Gibson, and then actually reading about it in magazines like Mondo 2000 and Boing Boing and a lot of other handouts, and starting to realize that there was a way of bringing your music literally home and then not having to work through other people to be at the very first stage of recording. And that's what really fueled this album. That's what's made it happen. This album took 10 months. The other two took 8 years.
I have made a very big decision. I'm gonna try to nullify my life.
Well, the direction of this album is cyberspace, cybernetic rock and roll dance music. And I think you can tell from this gear, I'm definitely creating my own reality here. What we've tried to do now on this album is bring disparate things into it and create the music all different sorts of ways so that it's not limited. That's the idea of this whole album, is to be multimedia. And it's just that it's very difficult to see at the moment just how far we can take it. But I know in the next few months, we'll be finding out, and so will you.
Well, I'm glad to be here laying down a few words on Billy Idol's new cyberpunk album. And I'm very, very turned on and zipped up by this new album. It's cyberpunk.
Timothy Leary came down, and one of Timothy Leary's big ideas is the space migration idea, which is really sort of a meditative idea. It was great to get him down, and we were able to use some of what he was saying in front of a song called Venus, which is very much about space traveling.
Operate your brain, link with my brain, open your eyeballs, power to the pupils, cyberpunk.
To join us all together in one sort of cyberdelic stream of consciousness mash around you, so should be pretty wild.
When I was a kid, I used to listen to The Doors a lot, and they gave me a lot of inspiration. Especially as, for me, Jim Morrison sort of expanded the sort of role of lyrics in rock and roll. At the time, it was wild. So I always loved the music. When I came to the States, I always, to live and make music, I always kept trying to figure out where Billy Idol would fit in. And one of the things that gave me hope was Jim Morrison. So one of the songs I sort of discovered when I first went to America was L.A. Woman. It was the sort of inspiration for things like White Wedding and Rebel Yell. Because I like that sort of trucking feeling. Anyway, apart from that, my love of The Doors and rock and roll eventually got me a part in the movie that Oliver Stone's just made of Jim Morrison's life.
Lost in a Roman.
And it was fantastic to find that somebody like Oliver Stone believed in me as an actor, because I don't look anything like the person you're seeing right now, even in the film with the role I've got now. But I was knocked out when Oliver Stone gave me a smaller part, but still included me in the movie. And I think, in a way, I still got a really great start in the acting profession.
There's a certain buzz you get off acting that's almost similar to being on stage with musicians, because there's a lot of interplay, and to make the whole thing happen, you have to be firing off each other. And it's very similar to playing a song, you know, to make a song come over successfully. Everybody playing the song has to be feeling and almost over-feeling it to make it work, and that's what happens in acting. You get the same sort of buzz, and that's what I believe my life's all about, is those sort of moments of excitement.
What to do? She's getting married and he's gonna ruin her life.
Yeah, Glenn doesn't deserve her. All he cares about are possessions. Fancy cars, CD players. Even women are possessions to him.
Yeah. See, Billy Idol gets it. I don't know why she doesn't get it.
I could tell from that and the internet by that time, you know, that there was sort of hope for me, because that was one of the great things, that about the same time as this kind of the hole in my career kind of happened, or whatever you want to call it, you know, about that time the internet came along and it really helped sort of keep everybody together. The internet gave a way for the fans and myself to communicate. And even the other day, I was looking at a girl, she's 16, I think she said, "I was 13 and I saw you in The Wedding Singer. I'm 16 now and I love Billy Idol." And I just thought, well, just as well I did that flaming film, because, you know, she would never have seen it, and now she wouldn't be 16 ready for this new album now.
How you doing, sir? Chicken or fish?
You better get out of my way, Billy. You're gonna get hurt.
Oh, yeah?
Don't you talk to Billy Idol that way.
Well, the problem with The Wedding Singer is that it cashed in on the retro sound.
Oh, yeah.
And being linked to a specific decade...
Yes, yes.
...is almost detrimental.
Well, yeah, but it was so funny. I just, because I read the script, I was cracking up. I could tell it was funny. And so even though it was retro, yeah, I just knew people were going to laugh in a way that wasn't retro. They were going to laugh because it's just funny.
It wasn't a bad song, you know. I'm going to tell those record company guys about you.
Mind if I give her a kiss first?
Oh, yeah, do what you got to do.
Yeah, in a way, look, the fact you could make fun of yourself, it can't be that serious, you know. That can't be your whole career. It couldn't have just been about the 80s, you know, if you see what I mean. Otherwise, I wouldn't, you know, wouldn't make fun of yourself if that's all you had.
Yes, I'd do it again, oh, wouldn't you? Yes, I'd do it again, uh-huh. Yeah, I'd do it again, baby. Wouldn't you?
There was a definite mindset attached to punk, some ideals. Those ideals, do they ever leave as you get older, or do you still hang on to them?
For me personally, I mean, it's always about being sort of true to what you feel is your calling, and that's all about your energy. And obviously, if that energy goes, then maybe I wouldn't do it, you know? But we've been doing this two-hour show for the last 5 years, and so I think, you know, I've got the energy all right.
The Lord cuts a million ways and shakes the devil if he misbehaves. You see, I ain't nobody's fool. Come on! Can't get up, never I do.
Bow, bow. I started being in a band when I was 20 in 1975, and by 1995 I thought, it was about time I took a break. So I wasn't playing with Steve Stevens, who really was part and parcel of Billy Idol right from the start. And I think in lots of ways, we needed to get back together to really
lay it on you one more time, and that's what we're doing right now.
Dancing with myself, oh, oh. Dancing with myself, oh, oh. Dancing with myself, oh, when there's nothing to lose and nothing to prove. Dancing with myself, oh, oh.
I think the great thing is, though, that I think we're in a state where we're not so messed up like we went through the 80s on some sort of conveyor belt of... And I think we're actually a lot better than we were then.
I wanted to take some time off because I love how you say to get free of yourself.
Yeah.
Oh, what do you mean by that?
Yeah, it's the hardest, it's the weirdest thing. It's actually Linda Perry said that to me. I've known her for a while, and me and Steve Stevens tried to write some songs with her, and it was just while she was doing it, she was saying, well, you know, what happened for me was that actually when I got out of Four Non Blondes, actually producing people and that, if I freed myself. And she said, that's what you've kind of got to do. I kind of know what she meant, that it's so easy to get lost inside the whole thing, the whole process, all the people and all the record companies and what other people want you to do and what you've done before and the whole mishmash of it all. After about 20 years, it was getting where you got to a point where if you don't somehow regenerate what you're doing, it's not going to come out right. You know? It just took a while to do that, you know. Majority of it at some point would have been thinking, well, how can I galvanize what I've done and put it back into motion? I realized it was going to take some steps, just gradual steps. You made sure the thing was right before you went ahead.
Robbed the cradle of love. I robbed the cradle.
Well, we kept playing. It wasn't that we weren't playing live or something like that. So, in fact, 2000 onwards, we had a new band that we were gradually putting into place, having a new songwriter as well as Steve Stevens. We've got double the songwriters now. I don't know, it just gave us a power that we needed. It gave us a freshness. It just took a while to get that back.
With this new record, you're going to be competing with a lot of bands who you've helped inspire.
Yeah, but at the same time, it's great in a way because, yeah, it tells you I've still got something relevant about what I did, dare I say it, 30 years ago. that actually still makes sense. And it means that sort of when I'm with this album, when we were kind of mapping the Billy Idol landscape, you know, like we went back through the journey of Billy Idol to make this record, it was fun, which meant we could go back to punk rock, which didn't put us that far away from, as you say, some of the groups today are punk rock groups.
You must have heard it over the years, people coming up to you and saying, without you, I would have never wrote a song or got up on stage and sing.
Yeah, well, I would say that to people, and they'd always look at me like I'm an idiot. So, but, yeah, well, I asked Pete Townsend once to write songs. Would you write some songs with you? And write your own. But that's what we told Pete. Anyway, so, so I have written my own, Pete. There you are. I can just keep doing this. I'll be okay. And the other thing is, I wouldn't mind hanging on to my hair. Because everybody else seems to be losing theirs at the moment.
So you're having a good time.
Yeah, I'm holding on.